Good morning.
Good morning.
Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. We're excited about how the Lord is leading us, and we don't have a great big crowd here, particularly compared to the services we experienced 2 weeks ago, but the presence of God is still just as strong. And he said, where there are two or three gathered together in his name, there he would be in our midst. And we are so pleased to depend upon that promise this morning. And so we're going to start off with some praise and worship this morning. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd, rock of all ages, almighty God is he. Bow down before him, love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd, rock of all ages, almighty God is he. Bow down before him, love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. And they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and shall not faint. Teach me, Lord. Teach me, Lord, to wait. You know, that song comes directly from the scriptures. But there's a great songwriter that put it to music way back, I don't know when, in the 50s perhaps. His name was Stuart Hamlin. Does that mean anything to you? He wrote some great songs. And Stuart came to a church activity when I was based in Fort Worth and was main speaker at one of our banquets, and I'll never forget as he began to talk about his relationship with God and how he'd come from a hard place and finally had found an opportunity to know God in fullness. And he put some verses to this song, and I can still remember him singing them. Teach me, Lord, to wait down on my knees, till in your own good time you answer my pleas. Teach me not to rely on what others do, but to wait in prayer for an answer from you. And teach me, Lord, to wait when hearts are aflame. Let me humble my pride and call on your name. Keep my faith renewed, my eyes only on thee, and let me be on this earth what you want me to be. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and shall not faint. Teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord, to wait. Oh, teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord, to wait. Praise the Lord. Karen, come ahead with the requests, anything that God has put on your heart.
This morning I had Mike on my heart while I was getting ready to come to church, and I get a call from Carolyn, and she's got the same thing on her heart and speaking the same thing she was hearing from the Lord that I was, and it was that I'm not accepting any bad report because we already know that God has all this in his hands and he's working it out. And she heard the same thing. So when I got here, Mike walked in the door and I text her. She's on the road coming from Ohio. And I said, Mike just walked in the door with a big smile on his face. And she just texted me back and said, Mike's not going to hang his guitar on a willow tree. She always says the most clever things to say. Crazy. But usually I don't even say much about our prayer meeting we have on Wednesday, but I have to tell you what happened. I felt to tell this. Wednesday, I was telling about, and whenever I leave the house to go out anywhere, I say, Lord, let me cross the path of whoever, let my timing be that I cross whoever's path I'm supposed to minister to, pray for, whatever. So I get to Walmart, and I go in and buy a few things, and I come out, and I'm looking in my purse, and I don't have my keys in there. And I said, I've never locked my keys in my car. And I'm always telling Tom about he forgets and leaves the keys and locks it. But anyway, I wasn't upset. I said, I called him, and I said, can I call AAA road service for, you know, unlock the car? Yeah. So I call him, and the lady says, well, there's only one person we have that in that area, And it was 10 o'clock, and she said, he will be there by 12:30. I said, 12:30? I'm thinking to myself. So she said, go inside and sit down and wait, and he'll call you or text you when he's almost there. So I go inside waiting, and in walks this lady I know down the road that I did her hair for years, and she said, oh, what are you doing sitting here? I said, well, I locked my keys in the car. She said, well, when I get through shopping with this other lady, I'll give you a ride home. And I said, okay, that would be a big help because I don't want to sit here for that long, 2 hours and a half. And the other lady that was with her said, well, go back in the auto department and see if they have one of those things done, Lockett. So I said, I'll do that. I go back there, and the lady said, well, we have one man that works that carries that kit, but he's not here today. It's his day off. So I said, well, God closed that door. So I go back up there and tell Helen, yeah, you go shopping when you're done. If I'm still sitting here, I said, I'll take a ride home. Well, this lady walks over, and she's got her grandson. And she, when I looked at her, I said, she looks just like an Eskimo. You know how you see pictures in there up north, Alaska, that they have a certain look. And she sits down, and the woman starts real close, just a few inches apart, starts telling me her life story. And she's taking care of her little grandson. He's living with her. And she says that she had open heart surgery. And she tells me, well, I moved here from Alaska. My husband was in the military, and we moved here 30-some years ago. And she said, I'm an Native Eskimo Indian. I said, oh, mm-hmm. So she tells me about her husband. She had open heart surgery, and then they had to go back in and have more. And she said, I knew when that doctor said, you need this done, you could have a stroke or a massive heart attack. So she said, before I had any fear come on me, I wouldn't have had it done. And then I had to go through it again. Something else happened. And her husband had knee surgery. She can't drive, and her husband had replacement knee surgery, and he's refused to get up and walk. So I have to walk everywhere, and she has to walk a few miles to Walmart. And I said to her, my heart was just going out to her as she's telling me all this stuff. This love and compassion. And I put my hand on her shoulder, and I said, on her arm, and I said, do you believe in prayer? She goes, oh yes, my sister in Alaska prayed for me when I went through my heart problem, and I'm okay now. And I said, well, I'm in a prayer group that meets on Wednesdays, and we're going to pray for you and your husband. She said, oh, thank you, thank you. And she's patting me. She was so, she heartfelt, she felt it, see, when I said that we were going to pray and God was going to move in her behalf. And I wrote their names down, and I got thinking, her grandson plays football. He's telling me how he's about 8 or 9. And I thought, you might be his coach. Are you a football coach for the little kids?
For 5 and 6 year old.
Oh, he's older. But anyways, he was so cute. When he heard me say that we were going to pray for his grandma, he got up there and put his arms around her and hugged her so tight. He just loved, you could tell he loved her so much. Such a sweet, cute little boy. And so I was telling that, and I said, I've got him on the prayer list. And Carolyn said, well, you know what happened to me yesterday? She said, when I first came here, this lady that owns, a Korean lady that owns cleaners, I went in there because I had one shirt that I messed up and I wanted to take it on my trip. But she said, I kept saying, I don't need that shirt. No, no, she said, I felt I had to go. And when she got in there, she said, where's the owner? And they said, she was in a terrible car accident yesterday. And they had to take the jaws of life and get the car to get her out of there, and she's got a broken leg. So, and Carolyn said, I said, that's why the Lord sent you there, because that was Tuesday and this was Wednesday, we're going to pray. And we began to, Carolyn, as we praise the Lord for a long time first, and then when we start ministering, it's not begging God. We speak what he speaks out of us to the person. And Carolyn and all four of us begin saying, this woman, she's planning a trip at Thanksgiving to go see her kids she hasn't seen for 5 years, and her new grandchildren she hasn't ever seen. And so we begin, all of us begin speaking the same thing. You do not have a broken leg. You are going to go on this trip. You're going to be okay. And Carolyn called me the day she left. She went by there, and they said, you know, her leg wasn't broken. And she's coming to work tomorrow. So we saw that miraculous, and that's the way God moves, you know. He puts us in the path of not just us, but everybody out here. You'll meet somebody, and I'm sure you hear, Zack, stories that you feel on your heart to minister to that person in your spirit, even if you can't tell them. But I knew that God was going to work in this, and we began speaking to that man for his leg, the fear to leave him, that he could get up and walk. And I know I'm going to run into that lady again, and I'm going to hear the good news. When we speak out of this right here, out of the Spirit, that is not, that's God talking. You know, it's not begging God to do something. We're speaking it because it's not us speaking it. Because we'd go along with the crowd and say, that's impossible. And I told, Carolyn said to me this morning, remember that message that, she wasn't here last week, that Mike ministered about, that's bad, no, that's good. I said, that's exactly what Bob said. Yeah. That is the truth. When something comes on you, it isn't bad. It's good. God is going to work something in this that seems terrible that you're walking through it, but we're surrounded by people that love us and care and are going to minister, and there's a lot of people out there don't have that. Amen. So when we run into somebody that needs our help, we're to give it to them, what the Lord gives us to give to them. We have to help them out of their predicament and bless them. So, does anybody have a special prayer request? Oh, he put his hand up. What is it? Tell us what you want us to pray for. Tell us, huh? Do you know, Jordan, what he wants? Well, God knows what he wants. God knows what's on his heart. I know. Do you know that when Mark was little, and he was probably 8 years old, something like that, and there was no services. Bob and Charlotte were out on the road, and we were going to this little church, and he came out of the Sunday school class, and he was crying, and I said, what's wrong, Mark? He said, I got such a burden for my daddy. He said that I asked the Sunday school class to pray for him, and I said, well, when they ask for prayer, and I said, you stand up, raise your hand, and ask for prayer for your dad. Well, he was an alcoholic, you know. So he did. He stood up, and there was not a dry, especially the women. They're all crying because this little kid stands up and said, I want everybody to pray for my daddy that he would quit drinking and move to Tennessee. And I goes, I don't want to move into Tennessee. I didn't want that there. And so anyway, he's prayed that, and do you know the next Sunday his dad drove all the way. Sandy gave him the money. He drove all the way here in a car, ran out of gas, and I had to go give him some gas. And he went to church, and when they get there, they asked if anybody needed prayer. He almost ran up there. And they prayed for him, these men, and from that day on, he never touched a drop of alcohol. And that was that little child's prayer. That was his prayer. And so God answers. He hears a little. He knows their hearts. And so, you know, Tom, totally, it was gone. God took it from him. But in my mind, I thought, I've watched him drink for 40 years. He's not going to quit now, you know. That's what your mind tells you.
That's right.
But see, out of his little son's heart was the Spirit. So we can believe all things through Christ, which strengthens us. Amen. Believe all things. He has the best interest of our what we need. We don't think we need a lot of things, but we do. A lot of changes in the way we think about what God's doing. Well, so let's all stand and Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you're our Lord, our Savior, our Deliverer. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you that you called us into this great army, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Talk about the soldiers on the battlefield. We're soldiers on the battlefield. We're fighting for creation. We're gonna set men free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, our army can be small, but God is mighty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are gonna conquer. Hallelujah. Through Christ, we are going to conquer. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, put all thoughts of death and destruction out of your mind. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hear from your Father. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. All things are possible in Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But you've got to get your orders out of the heart, not out of your mind. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, Jordan, what's your little boy's name? Brandon or Briley? Briley. Lord, you saw his heart. Lord, you know what's on his heart. Lord, answer his request. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Oh, Jordan, it's done. It's done. What that boy had on his heart, God's already on the move for it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We don't have to know what it is. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Bless this service, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You've got just who you want here, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise Him. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Well, I've got a praise report this morning.
Yes.
How many of you know what the name Andrew Tamarisi is? Well, you didn't hear what I had to say a few weeks ago, did you?
Oh, the Marines?
No.
Was he the Marine?
The Marine that was in Mexico.
Oh, yes, yes.
We just had bad recall. We heard you.
Oh, you heard me.
But I didn't remember the name.
Didn't remember the name. That's fine. Well, I brought his name to your attention several weeks ago. And I've been praying for him multiple times a day.
Amen.
Because several programs, Glenn Beck's got a TV show, and in the right lower corner of the screen, every time you turned on his program, you saw how many days Sergeant Tamarisi had been in prison. And you know, he was in prison for a very minor infraction. He was trying to turn around. He was near the Mexican border at Tijuana. And he was trying to turn around and get back to the United States. He hadn't actually crossed the border. But because of the inadequacy of the signs and being dark and him unfamiliar with the area, he took an exit that took him into Mexico. He had no choice.
Yeah.
And when he got there, he immediately told them, "I have guns, legal in the United States." But he knew it was a real challenge for the Border Patrol, for the Mexican government. And they incarcerated him. And Sergeant Tamarisi is a legitimate American hero. Served two tours of duty in Afghanistan. Saw one of his buddies, a man that he was helped, get both of his legs blown off. He was exposed to some of the most severe circumstances that you would find in combat and came back with a severe case of PTSD. We know how severe that is and how common it is. And he was actually in San Diego to get treatment. And got diverted down there for whatever reason. Was put in one of the worst prisons in Old Mexico, in that immediate area. Was abused to the point that he actually tried to take his own life. Of course, he's suffering from PTSD, along with being incarcerated and for I don't know how long, was shackled to his bed, his feet tied and his hands tied, and was treated very inhumanely. And it was a horrible thing. His mother, boy, you talk about a strong woman. She was on top of this, and she was dealing with everybody that she could deal with. And she was fighting for her son. And so I know y'all prayed, and boy, I've been praying. And we got some people involved. Got some Congress people involved. The president wouldn't even mention it when he talked to the president of Mexico on the phone. Wouldn't even bring it up. He was totally uninvolved. But we had some Congress people that got on. How many of you know who Montel Williams is? TV personality? Well, he's an ex-Marine. He got involved. God got involved. And it was an amazing thing. Over 100,000 people signed a petition. And that petition, by law, is supposed to require the White House to make a major effort. They ignored it. Absolutely ignored it. But God. And a mother. And I was sitting at the bar eating breakfast or lunch, I forgot which. And it flashed across the screen. Tamarisi has been released. A Mexican judge decided that he was unlawfully incarcerated. Release him immediately, he said. And they put him on a plane, flew him to Florida, where he's going to be with his mom and his family for a while. And that's a praise report. 214 days he was incarcerated for a minor, almost like a traffic ticket.
But God put it on your heart, Mike.
Yes.
Yeah, you know what? I felt that too.
Yes.
That was so on
that
your heart
was,
that day.
Yes.
That was your vision. God wanted
that,
you
touched
yes.
the throne with yes, that did. From your heart.
And I'm sure there's a lot of others.
Yes, but that was on
yeah,
your heart.
I felt it.
Well, it was a time of rejoicing
yes.
when we saw that.
Yes.
So I'm just thrilled
yes.
for Sergeant Tamarisi and his mother. And I was listening to Governor Richardson. He's been the governor of New Mexico. He got very involved. And another congressman from Arizona. And when they got through with their report, they said, well, if we ever get in trouble, we want Sergeant Tamarisi's mother on our side. She was a fighter. And so we blessed them this morning. Great report, great testimony, and so comforting to know that we can get involved with people's lives. And I'm also praying there's an Iranian Christian pastor. He and his family are from Iran, but they have come to the United States, and his family is here, got a beautiful wife and children. He went back to Iran almost in a missionary venue, and they've had him in prison for a long time. So keep this Iranian prison pastor on your heart. I believe that God will release him as well.
Yes.
Amen.
I believe he will. All right, Zack, come ahead. Minister to us this morning.
Hallelujah. Lane, I'm going to be reading from 2 Chronicles 32 here in just a minute. What an amazing thing the Lord's doing. We hear situations like that. How many knows that Mike Kelley probably couldn't have walked over there into Mexico and set that man free in the flesh, in the physical. But how many knows that Lord's going to begin to do things in a spirit like that, more and more for us? In the spirit, we're able to minister to these things that we have no control over, in the flesh. You know, we couldn't have went and lobbied to Congress and got all this stuff going and made any effort. I mean, the six or seven or however many is gathered here this morning, we couldn't do very much in the flesh, I doubt it. We could go march at the White House, do all we want to do. But in the spirit, we have power to move these things. Whenever we enter into the spirit and go to the throne room with these things, they have to be subjected to the spirit of the Lord. It's so amazing to see. I've heard other things about that during times of the Cold War and different things where people would really minister to situations and saw the Lord move. And how many know that's our calling? We're not just going to be able to see things done in this church building. Praise the Lord for the miracles we do see with our own eyes. But there's no telling what really we even touch. It's mind-boggling whenever we think about all the things we don't even maybe mention, and we get in the spirit with them and the things we're connected to that we don't even know we're ministering to them. It's just mind-boggling the ability of the Lord, the presence, the essence of who He is. It goes beyond all of our flesh and all of our knowledge. The Lord had laid something in my heart that's really right parallel with that, and it's such an interesting story. Whenever I got to, I was watching this TV show. I forget even what it's called now. It's about an archaeologist that goes through and he's kind of supporting biblical stories and biblical history without looking at it from just scripture, trying to prove it. He's looking at it through an archaeological perspective, and he's going to go back and give supportive evidence that parallels exactly what the Bible's saying. And he had a bunch of stuff going on, and he got on the story of Hezekiah whenever the Assyrians came to try to take over Jerusalem. And it was so interesting to me, though, in that story, and I'm going to minister a little bit out of it. But we know Hezekiah, I'm going to kind of skim through some stuff. I'm not going to read much of the verses at first, but it said whenever Hezekiah took over as king, he began to restore Jerusalem. He began to go into the Holy of Holies and cleanse it, and he began to go into the temple and began to open up the gates which had been shut, and he began to go in there and try to get Israel back right with the Lord, if you will. It says that he had said, "For our fathers have trespassed and have done that what was evil in the sight of the Lord our God, and they have forsaken him and have turned away their faces from the dwelling place for the Lord and have turned their backs." And what he was doing is beginning to restore Israel, beginning to sanctify the city, beginning to put it back on path with the Lord's will, and begin to worship the Lord again. And so what we see throughout the progression, as Hezekiah is doing this and having all this happen, then we see that really what I want to minister about is we see, I'm not exactly sure how to pronounce his name, but Sennacherib, king of Assyria. What? Yeah, Sennacherib, king of Assyria. They were coming at this time. They were taking over many lands, not just focused on Israel and Jerusalem, but they were taking over all kinds of lands, Egypt and all these lands, and they were headed toward the city. And so in one of the things that Hezekiah started to do is he rebuilt the city walls and he started restoring it, and not just the temple itself, but started really restoring the whole city, really created a lot of ways for the water to run through the city, because as we know at that time, that was an important part of cities is water supply, because it's not as it is today where you can just go down to the local market and buy you some bottles of water. So Hezekiah did a lot for the city of Jerusalem outside of just temple worship. And what we see is the king Sennacherib of Assyria coming toward Judah, coming toward Jerusalem. And what we see in the sixth verse of chapter 32, I want to read a few verses and minister on them. As Sennacherib's approaching the city, Hezekiah talks to the people, and he says in the sixth verse of the 32nd chapter, he said, "And he said, captains of war over the people, and gathered them together to him in the street of the gate of the city, and spoke encouragingly to them, saying," until the next verse, "Be strong and courageous, be not afraid or dismayed before the king of Assyria and all that the horde that is within them, for there is another with us greater than all those with him." Yes. Go on to the next verse. And it says, with him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And the people relied on the words of the Hezekiah, king of Judah. So what we see, and the thing about the army of the Assyrians, this wasn't a small army. This was an army that had taken over multiple cities. I believe the number he gave on that video was 185,000 were approaching the city. So in the natural, they had no control. I mean, they knew they were going to get taken captive. There was no, they had just now finally got the city rebuilt, got the walls put up, and they were really at a weak state in the time. And so what we see is that the king's approaching, and I want to go over to the 20th verse. Sennacherib's approaching, and he's really just saying awful things about the Lord. He's downgrading him. He's saying that, you know, I've taken over cities that had gods. We took over, you know, no matter what their gods, they couldn't handle it for them. They couldn't do anything for these people. So we're going to take your city the same way as we did the other ones. And kind of paraphrasing before I get to the 20th verse, it said the Assyrian king also wrote letters insulting the Lord. And as I say, he was talking really just degrading the Lord of Israel. He was saying, you know, y'all's God isn't any more important than any other God that I've defeated. So back to the 20th verse, it says, for this cause Hezekiah the king and the prophet Isaiah, son of Amos, prayed and cried to heaven. And this is what happened. It said that during this time where 185,000 people were approaching the cities, it actually says that the king's sitting there talking to people standing on the city wall. So this is how close they are. It's not just that they're miles out. I mean, they're on the city, on the verge of losing everything they have, everything that they've been revitalizing, all the stuff that they've been putting right. They've been putting their house in order. Let's begin to parallel it to the individual of us. They begin to set things in order. They begin to sanctify themselves. They begin to do all these things that the Lord's acquired from them. They begin to they set atonement for Israel for the first time in a long time. They started observing Passover again. They started doing all these things. And all of a sudden, here comes this huge army. And I believe we got people that's in a body right now like that, that has this Assyrian army at their doorstep trying to take over their land. It's I felt this so much to minister to Mike. I've never really had such a message that the Lord given me that was for somebody. Yeah. But I felt that too this morning, where it was for Mike Kelley this morning.
Oh, yes.
And I know a lot of people's going to parallel from it, but the Lord said there's a Syrian army at your doorstep, but he hears your cry.
Yes.
He hears the cries. It says he said they prayed and cried to heaven.
Yes.
The Lord hears all that. He hears the cries of our heart.
Yes.
And in the next verse, we see what happens. It said, and the Lord sent an angel who cut off all the mighty warriors and commanders and officers in the camp of the king of Assyria. It said, so the Assyrian king returned with shame faced to his own land. And when he came into the house of God, of his house God, they who were his own offspring slew him there with the sword.
Wow.
So how many know that God hears our cries?
Oh, yes.
And the Lord's going to send an angel. The Lord's sending angels. I hear it this morning. We're on both sides of this story. We have Assyrians coming to invade our land that we need an angel, but also we're going to be the angel.
Yes.
The Lord's sending some angels in this time. You know, there's debate over, I was watching that video, there's debate over exactly what the angel was that the Lord sent. Some say it was just direct intervention. The Lord slayed, turned the army away. Some say it was disease. Some say it was plague. Some say it was the Cushites. The Lord actually sent another people. It doesn't matter what the Lord's sending. The Lord's going to move. And the Lord's going to send somebody in the right time. God knows. That's what I was so, whenever you were saying that, it was so meaningful. Because God knows.
Yes.
He knows just the right time. Mm-hmm. Because how many knows the Assyrian army serves a purpose?
Yes.
The people of Israel, they were out, they couldn't do anything. I mean, they were weak.
Yes.
How many knows when we're weak, he's strong?
Yes.
They had to bring him to the end of themselves. They'd been restoring their city. They'd been doing all these things out of their own might, out of their own. And the Lord was honored, and he was pleased with it.
Yes.
But how many knows the Lord wanted to take him a step further?
Mm-hmm.
Because the place we're coming into, it's going to be God.
Oh.
It's going to be no more of our own will and our own flesh.
Oh, yes.
It's going to be no more of our own strength.
Yes.
He has to tear us down to build him up.
Oh, yes.
He has the Assyrians knocking on our doorstep, and we feel the pressure. We're starting to come up with our plans. We're saying, well, God, this is an impossible thing I'm facing. Everybody says it's impossible. Just like the Assyrians, there's 185,000 of them. It's impossible. We're going to lose the war. But how many knows just as they cried out to the Lord, there's a people that's going to cry out to the Lord no matter what they're facing. Yes. They're not going to turn their back on Him. They're going to cry out and say, God, only You can answer this. Yes. We give it to You, Lord. Only you can set us free of this. There's no other way. We could build up all the military we want. We could gather all our arms. But we have no power without You, Lord.
Amen.
It's going to take all the politicians, all the people. How many knows by the Spirit we're going to begin to minister to these things?
Yes.
We're going to begin to set things free in America, in the world, in our own lives, in other people's lives. As I say, we're going to be the angel, but we need some angels too. It's going to begin to work both ways. As we're set free, we're going to be the angel for somebody else.
Yes.
The Lord's going to begin to minister in the spiritual realm to things that we haven't been able to touch.
Yes.
Things that we can't touch in the flesh. How many knows by the Spirit, the Lord, that's what cried out. We were talking about that this morning. That's what cried out of Hezekiah, and I think it said it was Isaiah with him, is that was their spirit, the Lord crying out. The Spirit knew who it needed to cry on and leap to their man in their flesh. They would have began to devise plans to defend the city. They would have been able to say, well, we need to do this and do that. We need to set watchmen out and do all this. But how many knows, just as the story of Gideon,
absolutely.
As we ministered of Gideon, it wasn't in his will and his might. It was the Lord. And the Lord has the people of God facing things to try them. To see where their faith is. There's a deeper step in the Lord that's coming.
Oh,
there's a step where we're beginning to just get submerged into the water of life. Where we're going to say, I don't care how deep it gets. I don't care what it gets. I'm just going to go right in and trust that once I get there, God, it's going to be You.
Yes.
Because how many knows He's working so many things in us, in these things?
Yes.
We might say, well, that person, he doesn't have much flesh. You know, he's a good man. Why is he going through that? There's things that still have to be worked out of us.
Oh, yes.
And it's not just about us. It's about generations past.
Yes.
It's about generations to come. It's about human nature. It's not just about us. We can't. I think so often we get this selfish mindset where it's about us. It's like an input-output. Well, I didn't do anything wrong. Why is this happening to me?
Right.
That's not how it works in God. We're a body. It might be for your brother. It might be for your sister. It might be for generations past, because how many knows they're not gone anywhere?
Yeah.
They're still here. We might not see them, but there's still things being worked out of all those that we're tied with.
Yes.
We're still overcoming things for those already on the other side. We're overcoming things for, I mean, it's all in God. Who truly understands all of it? Only the Lord. So I believe the Lord's placing some things in our life that's testing our faith.
Yes.
That's building it, really. That's what a test is. It's to build you up.
Yes.
As you're going through school, they keep testing you to see how much you know and see how much you need to learn. And that's what the Lord's saying, is He's saying, whenever I'm placing the Assyrians outside your camp, are you going to call on Me, or are you going to figure this thing out?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord's putting us in a place where we have to rely on Him.
Yeah.
How many know that the difference of the feast we're walking into is that the Lord's not just going to let the flesh stay? In the Feast of Pentecost, He allowed, I mean, there is mighty moves of God, and there still is, and we see all that, but man's still unchanged. He's still man.
Yeah.
He's still just as fleshly as He ever was. And God's moving in those realms, and He's using those to fulfill a purpose, and He's instilling things, and He's teaching things, and we got to have it all. We can't do away with any of it. But how many knows we're walking into a feast where He's tabernacling Himself with us, and whenever God appears, death and has to flee.
Yes.
Whenever He begins to appear in our life, these things have to be judged and leave.
Yes.
The only way to become the fullness of God is to have some things judged.
Oh, yes.
And that's what He was doing with Hezekiah and them. He was judging them. He said, I'm going to see how much faith you have.
Yes.
I'm going to put your back against the wall and take you out of all control.
Yes, yes.
And we're going to let the Lord be the Lord, and you just be man for a little bit. How many knows that the Lord does use man and raises man up to do things in the midst of all the flesh that He still has? But I think the Lord's going to begin to get a people into a place where things got to change. In order for the Lord to do what He's wanting to do, things are going to have to change. And the Lord's going to do it. There's no way around it. The Lord's not going to allow the things to stay that were in all the other moves of God. This move of God's going to be pure, undefiled. That's the only way creation can be ministered to and changed. It's from a pure move of God. That's what we're starting to see in these things as the Marine being set free. And all these things is we're going to begin to see pure hearts ministering to these things in the earth realm. And the earth realm has no power over the pure things of God. It can't even begin to hold any barriers. An army of 185,000, as soon as the Lord sends an angel, it's done. It's over.
Yes, yes.
There's no way that it could. I mean, it's impossible in God for things to even stand up to the righteousness and the holiness of God.
Yes.
Whenever the Lord moves, He moves. It's not a halfway movement. If you have things in your life that still are unjudged, it wasn't because the Lord moved and failed. The Lord has them there for a purpose.
Amen.
He's allowing them to stay there to work something in you.
Yes.
Because we're still, there's a maturity that has to come to the people of God where it goes beyond just all the revelation and all the knowledge and all the interesting facts and all the aha moments and the Moses moments. And those are precious. But we got to begin to move past that. Whenever we're changed, that's going to be such a glorious state where there's no more of this up and down. Things aren't going to be so much aha anymore because that's just the way it is at that point. It becomes a normal. I've heard that somebody say that we call so many things supernatural. That's what we should call natural, or the supernatural things.
Yes, yes.
Those should be natural to us.
Yes.
Not to bring them down to a lower level, but that should become common ground to us. That should be what we're walking in.
Yes.
We should be seeing people set free. We should be able to pray for people that are hostage and see them set free. Not just in the physical prisons, but in these spiritual prisons.
Yes, yes.
We should begin to minister to people and see a people brought into a greater place in God.
Yes.
And I believe that's what we're going to begin to see more and more through these prayer meetings and through our personal prayer time and all these things.
Oh, yes.
But how many knows that the judgment starts at the house of the Lord? It all has to start here.
Amen.
And how many knows the Lord's judging a people?
Yes.
And those people are going to be tried and true and be steady and firm. They're going to be the people that doesn't move until God tells them to move, that doesn't pray until God tells them to pray, that doesn't try to touch things that the Lord's still doing. They're going to leave it there to work its course, but they're going to go out and minister to the things that the Lord's telling them to minister to.
Yes.
It's such a training that we're in with being able to hear and see and do all these things that are required. See, I mean, even Paul, back in his day, he saw things that are taking place now.
Yes.
He couldn't have made them happen back in his day. They weren't meant to. He ministered to the things that he was called to minister to. And that's what we have to see. We see things that are the end result. But we still have to minister to the things that are in front of us right now.
Oh, yes, yes.
We can't get too far ahead of ourselves.
Yes, yes.
Because we have to realize where we're at. We have to get that clear vision of where we're at and minister to it.
Yes.
We can't just see the end and just sit down and lay down and say, well, God's going to do it, so let's just wait till he does it.
Nope.
We still have to minister to it. And I believe that I believe God's going to do it. I do believe that. I don't think he just has to have man to fulfill his plan, but he chose to use man.
Yes.
So he's going to keep prying you and keep poking you and keep shoving you and keep moving you.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord's not going to give up on us.
No.
No matter how much we get down on ourselves, no matter how much we think we got too much flesh, no matter how many Assyrians are camped outside of us, no matter what we're facing in our life, the Lord is not going to allow us to lay down. If you're called into this move of God, he's not going to allow you to lay down. It's impossible.
Yes, it's impossible.
It's as we were talking about last week, it's just, it's unlawful. It's not the way this thing's going to work anymore.
Mm-hmm.
There's not going to be people coming and going and coming and going in this revolving door with God and playing games and doing all this. There's a people that's walking in this Feast of Tabernacles. It's going to become tried and true, because as God starts appearing and starts tabernacling himself, that's what I say, it's no more this struggle. It's just starting to happen.
Yes. Yes. Yep.
As he starts appearing, things start changing.
Yep. Yeah.
It really doesn't take as much might on our part as we think it does.
No.
We just got to sit back and let God be God. We just got to sit back and cry out and say, Lord, I need you.
Amen.
Because I got all these people camped outside the city and I got all these things I'm facing and I can't do it. That's all it takes. It doesn't take us getting all this strength and praying and doing all this stuff. And I'm not saying that's bad. Obviously, we need to pray and we need to hold when the Lord lays that in our heart. But we have to come to the place where we're going to allow God to be God.
Yes.
Where we are going to pray and then sit back and let God do it.
Yes.
Where we're not going to go pray for somebody. And as we're Karen was mentioning that this morning, whenever we see somebody and we feel that in our spirit to pray for them, we can't just go out in the natural and try to fix it. We got to pray it and then let God be God. We just got to sit back and watch, because in our flesh we can get impatient. We can start questioning things. We can start saying, is it ever going to change? This is getting worse, God. The doctors are starting to say there's not too much time. The doctors are saying that things are changing. But God doesn't listen to doctors.
That's right.
God doesn't listen to man's advice.
No.
He doesn't start saying, well, man says this is impossible, so I got to listen to him.
No.
With God, all things are possible.
Yes.
And God's going to keep moving in our lives. And I had Mike so heavy on my heart this morning too, that if the Lord's going to move, He's going to send an angel. It's inevitable. He hears the cries of your heart. Hallelujah, Father. We just praise You and honor You this morning, Lord. And we thank You, Father, for what You're doing in our lives, Father. And we just lift up Mike, Father. We bring him before the throne of Your grace, Father, and just ask for You to move in this vessel, Father. We know that there's no death that can abide in Your holy city, Father, that we know that You're testing and trying it, Father, but we know He's going to be victorious, Father, that there's going to be a white horse riding through His land, Father, that there's going to be victory and honor and praise, Father. And we just glorify You, Father, in advance, Lord, and we just give it to You, Father. We're going to let You be God in this situation, Father. We're going to lay down all our thoughts, Father, and we're going to lay down all of our trying to do things, Father, and we're just going to let You be God. Hallelujah, Father. Hallelujah, Lord. And we just thank You, Father, and we honor You, Lord. Hallelujah, Father. Thank You, Father. Yes, Father. Hallelujah, Lord. Yes, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Father. Glory, Father. Hallelujah. Yes, hatara mashanda. Kia mashanda ramata. Thank You, Father. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. You see, the Lord's heard our cries. We all have our cries. We all see our moments of darkness. But there's always a light. Nowhere in the universe is there a place that doesn't have light. That's proven through science now. We've known that to be true all along, because God's Word isn't... I mean, we can just trust the Word alone. But even science has proved that there's nowhere in the universe without light. There's nowhere within our vessel that there's not a speck of light.
Amen.
And I just thank God and praise and honor Him this morning for what He's doing. And I'm just believing God for all these things.
Oh, yes.
I mean, I especially have Mike in my heart this morning, but I know that there's so many things going on in all of our lives.
Yes.
That I'm just trusting that God's going to be God, and He's going to move and change things. He's going to change who we are.
Oh, yes.
Because the more He transforms us and the more we become like Him, the more the atmosphere around us changes.
Oh, yes.
The more things begin to just move on their own.
Yes.
Because once things have to clear away when God's coming through.
Oh, yes.
It's not that... I mean, it's just an automatic. I don't even really have the right words for it. It's not that God has to even do anything. When He's there... It can't be there. Death can't be there. Darkness can't be there. None of that can be there. It's impossible. So as the more and more that the Lord begins to change us and make us in His image and likeness, and the body as a whole, not just us individually, things are going to begin to change.
Oh, yes.
And we have to believe that.
Yes.
It can't. I mean, I know that we see the end result, and we can't lose faith that that's going to be it, but we have to see where we're at.
Mm-hmm.
We have to allow the Lord to be the Lord and change us so that we can be like Him. Because we can't change things the way we are right now.
Amen.
And we're never going to come up with the perfect plan and the perfect idea to change things.
No.
We're going to have to pray and seek His will. I was at a work and we were doing a lesson with the guys on wisdom. And that's what somebody said wisdom was. It wasn't, you know, we often think of wisdom and we think of knowledge and all these bright ideas and somebody that can outthink people and just know things. But he said that wisdom, he thought, was knowing the will of the Lord.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's the only true wisdom.
Yes, it is.
Is to know the will of the Lord. That's why. That's to be wise.
Yes.
As I say, to know that that's the will of the Lord and to leave it alone. Or that that's the will of the Lord and pray for it and try to see it move. That's true wisdom. Whenever we say we're seeking wisdom from the Lord, what are we really saying? That we're wanting God to make us a little smarter? That we want to see His will and we want to see it done in our lives and other people's lives. So we're seeking His will, His wisdom. Because God has a plan, and that plan's not going to change. For each one of our lives, no matter what we got facing, if God's plan is something in our lives, it's going to be done.
Yes. Yes.
And so I'm just excited this morning because I need this word just as much as anybody else here. I need to see some things move, and I just got to sit back and let the Lord hear my cry and see some things move. And so I'm just thankful and honor the Lord this morning, and I just lift Mike so much up in my spirit, and I know all of us are. Because
yes.
what a mighty man of God, what a precious man,
yes.
what a righteous man, what a man that's just such a character to want to be like.
Yes.
It's such an honor, really, if I think about it, what the Lord's allowed me to partake in.
Yes.
I mean, not just building up flesh, but to be honest,
yes.
to be ministering before Mike Kelley, one of the best pastors there could be.
Yes.
A man that, I don't see him judging people.
No.
He sees things as they are, and he doesn't judge them. He doesn't say, well, look at him, and he's over here doing this and that. And he. I mean, if you want to look at wisdom, that's wisdom.
Yeah.
I mean, Mike has wisdom. And I honor that because we all learn from it. What more from a pastor would you want than wisdom?
Yeah.
To be able to seek the will of the Lord and see the will of the Lord and to act out of that and to speak out of that and to move out of that. So I just honor and praise the Lord this morning and thank him for all that he's doing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Zack. That's a tremendous encouragement and such a vital word for where we are.
Yes, yes.
And I would like to express my appreciation this morning to all of you for the support and strength. Knowing that as we support each other, there is a reciprocal action. You know what that means? It comes back to you. And so I'm confident that as you minister to me, that you're going to be ministered to as well. And as I minister to you, I'm going to be ministered to. And I was thinking this morning as I was driving over, just taking that opportunity for the quiet time, and to recognize that there are significant things that are injected into our lives, that are presented to us, that have synergy. You know what that means? Science has tried to isolate certain beneficial elements from different parts of our normal diet, vegetables, fruits, various things, and take these very singular items and put them into some concentrated form that you can take a pill. Instead of eating an orange and getting your vitamin C, you take a pill. But there's other things in that orange besides the vitamin C. And all of these elements are synergistic. They work together. When you eat a plant like broccoli, you get more than just an individual element. You get a multiple benefit. And all of these things working together. And they are designed to work together so well that without having them in compatibility and accompanying each other, the individual items don't work very well.
Yeah.
Sometimes they don't have much of effect at all. And so we all together create a synergistic reaction.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And so I was thinking this morning, now we're very conscious of Karen's ministry, this the way that God uses her, and I was so impressed with how God used her little, oh, that's bad, no, that's good situation about locking the keys in your car. And you know, a lot of times we can just let an element like that just tear up the whole day.
Oh, yeah.
Well, now this is just my luck. Yeah. It's going to ruin everything today. But it became an opportunity to be a blessing.
Yes.
And what is more important? Getting back home and maybe doing some housework or being there to minister to someone,
yes,
who's in need.
Yes.
So we see that. We hear the ministry coming from Zack and the dramatic way that God has increased him and his ministry. But we are all involved in this. I'm feeling strength from you, Phyllis, that I wouldn't get from anyone else.
Yes.
There's a element of strength that is essential to make this synergistic application have its full effect. From Sandy, from Jordan. Jordan, you and I are walking separate paths but similar paths. The challenges that we're facing. And it's important that we work together and to support each other in this. You have a ministry. And for you to be here, and I was thinking this morning how Briley is getting ministered to as he is ministering, even at his age.
Yeah, oh yes.
There's something happening. You see, there's a... God knows.
Oh, yes.
God knows. This circumstance that has, from an outward appearance, disrupted a family life, and Briley being one who would be affected by it, God knows, and he knows how to supplement that and keep him from being a victim of the situation. And we don't have to say, oh, I wish we'd done something different. How could this change? God has been talking to me about this because it would be real easy for me to go back 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years and say, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? Well, probably I was not doing what I was supposed to do, but that doesn't tie God's hands. Just because I made a mistake or I was lax in judgment or I was not aware doesn't mean that God didn't have a plan. And he took, we say it often, he knows our downsittings and he knows our uprisings, and he can take all of those things, even our mistakes. And boy, that's where it really comes down to believing Romans 8:28 that says all things work together for good.
Yes.
All things, even my mistakes.
Oh, yes.
Even my mistakes, even our judgment or lack of,
yes.
God overrules that and causes it to work for our good.
Yes. Yes.
And so I cannot be despondent or condemning of myself of what I did or did not do. Either yesterday or 5 years ago, nor can you. You can't go back and say, well, if I'd have done this differently, if I'd have heard their advice and taken their advice, then this wouldn't. God knows.
Yes,
he knows. And he takes it all into consideration, and his plan, I hear this often, and his mercy endureth forever.
Yes.
His mercy endureth forever. It takes in consideration all of these things. And your ministry, I was thinking of the importance of Landon's ministry this morning. I mean, it is a very special thing for anyone, Zack or myself or Bob or whoever, to be able to see these things on this screen. What a blessing it is to you to see the words of a song or the scripture and to participate, and the consistency that Landon is showing in his ministry right here at the church. We are all working together, and it's a very positive thing. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart, because it's not just for me. Thank you for your ministry to me, but it is for the body of Christ and for creation as a whole. It sure is. So that's my thanks this morning. Sincere thanks to you. And for the ministry and the strength that I feel from you. I was impressed by a lady that we have been introduced to just over the last few years. Got to know her quite well. She happens to be the close lady friend of my son-in-law's father. David, Ginger's husband, his father, has this lady that they're very close friends. I don't think there's any real strong romance involved. It's companionship. When you get to be in your 70s and 80s, you know, companionship's more important than romance. But there's a compatibility there, and they appreciate each other, and it's a beauty in their relationship. She was a nun for many years, and for whatever reason left that position, but maintains a very strong activity in the Catholic Church. And I think all of us who are more or less separated from the more highly liturgical churches have a lack of understanding, and maybe some concepts and some ideas that are probably not always correct, because we have an idea of that strong disciplinary rigid type of worship as being not as personal and not as effective as what we feel like that we have with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and the relationship that we have. And that, to me, is probably a mistake on our part. It's judgment that is not exactly correct. And so after meeting Jean, I've had some real changes in my opinion, because I've seen the sincerity and the genuine love that she has for God and for His creation. And we have become very close to Jean and to Al, David's father. They came out to the ranch on two or three occasions, and we've had the opportunity to really share in a lot of different ways. In fact, we play music every Thursday night at a little place in McEwen. By the way, all of you are invited. If you ever want to come to a little country convenience store and sit there and listen to three old boys play a little country music with a little gospel mixed in, a little blues or whatever, you're welcome. We play from 6 until 9 on Thursday nights. Well, David's dad and his lady friend Jean came, and they've done this more than once, and so they were there Thursday. And as they got out of the car, I was leaving my car going into the little convenience store. As they were coming in, and Jean handed me a manila envelope, and she said, "I gave this as a presentation to one of the groups that I'm in charge of at the church, and I wanted to share it with you." And so I'll be speaking, and she'd given me something before that I incorporated into this, and it's just, I could feel the love that she was expressing, and I really recognized it as being significant by the Spirit. So I honor Jean this morning and appreciate what God is doing. And there's a comprehensive nature in what I'm trying to say this morning. You see, God knows. And He's always known. And so I'm seeing something in a more comprehensive fashion this morning, and I want to try to put this together, so bear with me. I'm not one that sits down and outlines a sermon. Good. I see often, and I watch people on TV, TV preachers, and I'm not being critical at all, but evidently they've got every word written down, because you see them turning pages, you know. Or if they've got their iPad or whatever, you can tell that there's, well, I'm not that organized. But God gives me concepts and ideas, and then we try to put it together by the Spirit. But I was thinking, see how fresh the provision of God just for this morning, because I got something this morning that was, this message on Hezekiah was a tremendous message, Zack, and a tremendous encouragement.
Yes.
And coming from Second Chronicles, that's fresh. I mean, it's been written there for for centuries, but that was fresh by the Spirit.
Yes.
And was given to us, and particularly to me, mm-hmm. as encouragement for today.
Yes.
Give us this day our daily bread. But, you see, God is able, and you see, when you go back and look at the children of Israel being provided manna, God was able to, and he said, look, you gather every day for what you need, except on the day before the Sabbath, you gather enough for both days. And he was able to preserve that he wanted them to have. And I don't think he was limited to 24-hour preservation. Now, if man tried to preserve it, it got worms in it. But God can take any blessing that he has, and he can preserve it for as long as he wants, and interject it into your life, and it may be something that happened to you 5 years ago, or 25 years ago, or 50 years ago. If we start getting into people my age, I start pulling things up, and I'm starting to see the comprehensive nature of God's involvement with me as an individual, as an identity that began, as we know, before the foundation of the earth. And so God knew me before the earth was formed, and he knew me as an identity, and he knew me this morning. God knows. That's the fullness of God's understanding of us as individuals. That's the depth of his love and of his purpose that we're involved with. And it's becoming so dramatic and so amazing in my mind as this is starting to be formed, and particularly in the situation that I'm walking. Purpose. Now, there's a lot of things going on, and I'll share just a little bit because I think God's encouraging me not to be so private.
Yes. Right.
Most of you have known me as being a very private person. And in a lot of ways, that's good. But in some ways, it's not.
But we're part of your body.
There's a need of being open. Confessing your faults one to another. Being transparent. And so, you know, I'm looking at this next week of being in the hospital every day for a short period of time. Every day this next week. They called me Friday and said, can you come in Monday morning at 6:30? Wow. Yeah, I can be there. But I got some good news. They said what we have found is not as invasive and not as deteriorating as we thought. So along with the requirement, there was good news.
Yes.
So I'm looking at this, and I asked the question. Now, in all of these activities, this specific one, which is an MRI in the morning, and then the radiation treatments Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, am I going to be able to drive myself? Because, hey, it's an imposition on somebody. If I can't drive, oh yes, this is not going to be debilitating. You can drive yourself, and you won't feel any effects. And so that's good news. That's good news. And so, as I'm looking at these things and seeing the challenge of it, it's making me step out because, you know, it's an hour and 10-minute drive one way, then an hour and a half procedure, then an hour and 10-minute drive back. That's a chunk out of my day. I'm going to have to be more active. I'm going to have to be more aggressive. I'm going to have to be up at a certain time and meeting a schedule, which I've been pretty casual for the last few weeks. And so it's putting demands on me that I think are positive, that are making me step up. And so that's my little report to you on where I am right now. But God has been bringing some things together, and he showed me something just in the last few days, and more particularly this morning, that I think is very effective in my understanding of what God is doing, and I hope it applies to you as well. I've never been one to sit down and play games or work puzzles. I always want to be out doing something. But I have on occasion taken a box that had a bunch of pieces, and we call them jigsaw puzzles. Some of them pretty intricate. Did you ever get one out that covered up the whole table and had, you know, hundreds and hundreds of pieces? And I saw my life as a jigsaw puzzle. And I started saying, okay, God, you're putting together. And on the front of the box is the complete picture. Zack mentioned this morning, we can see what the end is going to be. We've got a ways to go between now and then, between here and there. But I started seeing my life as a jigsaw puzzle. And God having specific pieces that are essential for the complete picture. You see, you can put this all together, and if there's a half a dozen pieces missing, it's a glaring thing. Mm-hmm. It'll stand out. Yeah. You're not through. You're not complete. Mm-hmm. This picture is not like it's supposed to be. Yes. And so I was looking at some of the things that God is doing. You see, I got a piece of the puzzle this morning. Mm-hmm. It was fresh. But then there was a piece of the puzzle that came to my mind. And bear with me as I'm a little personal about this. I was raised, fortunately, in a very spiritual environment. And there were some people that my family, my mother and dad in particular, were involved with that were very, very spiritual people. There was a family. Their name was White. This was back in the days when we called people brother and sister. You know, and I never knew her by anything but Sister White. Her name was Lanoa, and she had several children, all of them older than I. And one of them, who was probably 15 years older than I, maybe 20, came down with spinal meningitis when he was a teenager. And back in those days, they knew very little about how to deal with it, and he ended up with an impaired physical. One side was paralyzed, and he lost his ability to talk. But he loved the Lord. Oh, it was an amazing thing. His name was Richard. And he could say very few words in conversation with you. He had his own little language. And I could repeat a half a dozen words that he would say that was just Richard. If you didn't know him and if you weren't in the involvement of the conversation, you wouldn't have any idea what they meant. You know, they were just the utterances that he could make. But he would come to church, and his sister, Lahoma, played the piano beautifully, and he would sing. I can hear him. With his lack of verbal ability, transform from that handicap to a ministry as he stood up to sing. So I'll share with you this morning. No, he passed away. In the natural, he's gone, but by the Spirit, he's... So this is that piece of the puzzle.
Yes.
That I've known for all of these years, but I've never had a place to put that piece as correctly as I have today. I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry o'er the future, for I know what Jesus said. And today I'll walk beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know he holds my hand. I don't know about tomorrow. It may bring me poverty, but the one who feeds the sparrow is the one who stands by me. And the path that be my portion, it may lead through flame or flood, but his presence goes before me, and I'm covered with his blood. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know he holds my hand. I don't know about tomorrow, but I know he holds my hand. Praise the Lord. Say something.
Mike was going to dismiss you. I'm sorry. I just wanted to say this because when Mike was on my heart too. So, but anyway, but not maybe in the way that everyone has. But I want to say I've been listening to these tapes, these CDs from the meetings.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I just want you to know what happened to me, okay? Because I've been praying, and God gave me one word I gave to you. That's
yes.
The word, okay?
Yes.
And so I begin to pray, and I'm praying, God knows everything, okay? And I'm saying, now, Lord, you know. You know that that's your temple, and that's an invasion in your temple, you know, and all this and all that. Anyway, so, but then I begin to listen to the tapes or the CDs, and I wasn't here for but just one meeting, and I wished I had been, but this tape Mike was on, all right, and I was listening to his words, and they were pure words, I'm going to tell you. He was saying he was in the best place
you ever
yes.
were.
Yes.
I mean, I was listening. I was listening to all this, okay? And I'm picturing in my mind, because I see Mike, you know, and I'm picturing in my mind, what it did was it took me right straight to Jesus.
Amen.
I'll just put it as plain as I can make it. In the Spirit. In the Spirit. It just took me right straight to Jesus, and I saw again what I just can't, I wished I could explain what I saw in the Spirit, but it took me in the Spirit right to that place, you know, where Jesus was having to go to the cross.
Yes. Yes.
And he said it was needful.
Yes.
You know, I mean, yeah, it just took me there, Mike. I don't know how to explain that.
Wow.
Okay. And all I saw in Mike was Christ. All I saw. And I saw it on this tape listening to these words. I mean, and I just want to, you know, this is what I'm thinking, Lord, what is this? 1 minute we're praying, whammo, you know, get out of there, you know. And the next thing we're praying, oh my, but I see something here. You know, I see what God is doing. He's working this all out in us. And we are going to emanate our God.
Yes.
And this is what was emanating through there on that CD.
Yes.
And it was emanating right in my car, you know.
Wow.
I didn't even have to be present.
Amen.
And I thought, how beautiful. Oh, that we all could just, you know, we may have to, I mean, yes, there's a cross, and yes, nevertheless, they ain't going to be no strange things invading our temple, you know. We're going to walk through whatever we have to walk through.
Yes.
But wherever we're at, we're in the best place we have ever been.
My.
We're in the best place.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, Phyllis. That is so encouraging, because you weren't here, but God made it available to you. My wife was downstairs, but this morning she's got the CD as she drives to Paris. Now, how many people have got that CD? Y'all have mailed out a lot of them. And all of the different elements of those services are now available to numerous people. And this is an explosive thing. And expands exponentially. It's on the internet. Oh, wow. How much bigger can it get? And I plan to have a conversation with our friend in Texas. You remember I mentioned that she wrote both these songs. This is the best place I've ever been. Now, Faye Simons is one of the most unassuming people that you would ever meet.
She wrote that.
She wrote that.
Oh.
And she is humble to a fault. But how many people is that song ministering to today? And how many people will it minister to? We have no understanding of how far these words, the words you spoke this morning, Phyllis, from this microphone, going out in the same fashion, with the same unlimited ability of speaking that. So we've got a powerful pulpit. We've got a powerful place of speaking and a powerful ministry right here in this little church. And it is so wonderful to see it in its action and effectiveness. Praise the Lord. I'd like to bring to your attention something this morning. Just briefly, I don't think we'll go much further. We've had a visitation here already this morning. I really have. I would like to put together this comprehensive picture that I'm talking about to encourage you as well as myself to come to an awareness, a greater awareness of God's awareness of you. Now, we have difficulty many times comprehending God's abilities. If we started going through all the personalities of God this morning, it would take hours to just try to put it in some type of capsule of God and His ability. But I'd like to concentrate it this morning into a much smaller approach, or a more direct approach, of God's knowledge of you. Now, we've already quoted scripture this morning, and we won't go to that scripture now, but in paraphrase, that before the foundation of the earth, so another lady in Texas wrote the song, "I was born in the mind of God before all time began. I was raised in love before the age of sin." Something was mentioned just the other day, maybe in the services. I think Bob might have said something. I was aware of this story, and I don't know where it came from. And I'm sure other people have heard this story. But there was a family who had a young child, but was old enough to talk and communicate and have some understanding, probably the age of Briley or somewhere in that age. And they were expecting another child. And as normal, the little boy was excited about having a new baby sister. And he showed all the natural inclinations of curiosity and interest when they brought this new baby home. But they started to detect something about his attitude towards his little sister that was concerning them. They didn't feel like that he was being a threat, but he was looking for opportunities to be alone with his baby sister. They were concerned to the point that they tried to ease him out of those situations and not give him a chance to do something that they didn't really know what he would do. They didn't think he would be violent or destructive or do anything to hurt the child or the baby. But they were still very uncomfortable with the opportunity of him spending time alone at this early stage, just a few days after they'd brought the baby home from the hospital. And finally, through some consideration and discussion, they decided that if he was so intent to have this private time with his little sister, they would give him that opportunity, but they would be monitoring him. They had one of those camera monitors that they could hear the sounds and see exactly what was going on, and give him his time of privacy and still be able to observe what was going on. And so with great interest, they told him, okay, you've been wanting to go talk to your little sister? Okay, you can. And we won't come in thy room. You'll be all by yourself. He went into the nursery and shut the door. And he walked over to her bed. And he said, tell me about God. I'm forgetting. You remember, because you just came. I'm getting old enough that I'm forgetting about him. Tell me about him. This child knew that his baby sister had just come from a relationship with God that was very special and very private. And he desired to know and to return to that in some fashion. Now that struck a chord in me and made me realize that deep inside us, there is something that's crying out for our knowledge. And from this writing that this lady gave to me Thursday night, I'll bring up some things here that is basically called a longing for God. And I think we're all experiencing that, a longing for God, for various reasons. Sometimes our longing for God is for a rescuer because we're in trouble. Sometimes our longing for God is to give us understanding because we don't know about tomorrow, but we know He does. Sometimes our longing for God is for companionship that is not supplied by our natural relationships. It's from a deeper place. As we consider the fact, and I think we're privileged people to know that we began in these eons before. We didn't begin at conception and we didn't begin at birth. We began in the mind of God. And there's nothing more real than that that's in the mind of God. This is not imaginary. You see, from the mind of God, He spoke everything into existence. Now, it was already in His mind, and it was just as real then as it was when He said, let there be light. Yes. So how far back do you go? I can't comprehend that. But you and I go back in our individual identity. And if you read some of the things that Elwin Roach is writing, you'll hear this depicted in similar fashion, that we were with God when He said, let us make man in our own image. We were with God when He started describing the magnitude of the universes that He was going to speak into existence. We were individuals at that time. We knew His individual love and relationship with us even more so then than we do now. Our understanding now is in part, and it's kind of on again, off again, as Zack talked about. But we're moving to a better place to where it's a more consistent thing. And our knowledge and our understanding of God is causing Him to be real in our daily activities and in everything that we face. If you'll go to Psalms 138, please, Landon, first verse. And we'll look at this verse. And this is David talking. And we'll probably look at it in two or three translations. I will confess and praise you, O God, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises unto you. Next verse. I will worship toward your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and for your truth and faithfulness, for you have exalted above all else your name and your word, and you have magnified your word above all your name. Now that's our introduction, and that's our praise and worship as we enter into his holy place. Next verse, please. In the day when I called, you answered me, and you strengthened me with strength and might and inflexibility to temptation in my inner self. Now, as we look at these verses, let's go back to 138 and the first verse and look at it in the message, if you don't mind. Thank you. Everything in me says thank you. Angels listen as I sing my thanks. Next verse. I kneel in worship facing your holy temple and say it again. Thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your faithfulness. Most holy is your name and most holy is your word. Next verse. The moment I called out, you stepped in. You made my life large with strength. Now this is God present. But God was just as present in your life before the foundation of the earth as he is today. He was just as present in your life 3 years ago as he is today. He was just as present on the day that you were converted or saved, however you want to phrase it, as he is today. He was involved in your life. In another place, David says, truly you have formed my innermost being. You knit me in my mother's womb. Okay, see what he's doing? He's taking you back and seeing how you were involved with God and God involved with you. I give you thanks that I am fearfully and wonderfully made. When were you fearfully and wonderfully made? In the mind of God. Before the foundation of the earth. Wonderful are your works. My soul also you knew full well. Nor was my frame unknown to you when I was made in secret. Made in secret. He knew you. So we are having to expand our understanding of God's knowledge of us. And when we start to get the picture of the intimacy of his knowledge of us as individuals, what does that do? It expands God in our mind. It makes God greater than we've ever known him to be. It causes us to have a greater vision and a greater understanding of who he is, and then gives us confidence that if God has known me as an individual for all of these years, eons, and the 71 years that I have lived in this human form, how much more should I be confident that he knows about my tomorrow? As I get up early in the morning and I made my transverse to the hospital, God knew about this trip before I did. He knew about this diagnosis before I did. And he has a plan and a purpose for it, for me, and it is going to be for my good. He has began a good work in me and in you, and he is just and faithful to fulfill that good work.
Yes.
Now, as we go through things, we find that we have all kinds of adjectives for the things that we go through. A man, Ron Rollheiser, who wrote The Holy Longing, describes the intimate sense of loneliness and longing that can be in our heart. He says that in the center of the human experience is a unquenchable fire, a restlessness, a gnawing nostalgia, a wildness that cannot be tamed, and an all-embracing ache. Do you think that that little boy who wanted to have that opportunity to talk to his little sister was experiencing, even at his young age, an unquenchable fire, a restlessness, a gnawing nostalgia? That struck me, gnawing nostalgia. Nostalgia, that means something that you look back on and long for. Gnawing nostalgia, a wildness that cannot be tamed, an all-embracing ache. Then Dr. Rollheiser says, it is only when our search for happiness turns us inward to the temple of God within that we find wholeness, holiness, real happiness, and peace. You see, God is wanting us to know that He knows. God knows. And His knowledge of us is so much greater than anything that we've ever been able to comprehend. Bob wrote a song. We've sung it at funerals, I know he has. Many times, I can't tell you the exact words. My heart's cried out, "Why, Lord?" How many times I've cried out, "How long, Lord?" But the refrain says, and I saw angels picking up the teardrops that fell from the cheeks of the saints. I saw angels taking them to heaven. And there he put them in a bottle of remembrance. He knows. God knows. So, with this understanding of how expansive God's knowledge is, where do we find opportunity to be fearful? You can't be afraid if God knows and you know that God knows. It's only when you feel like you're alone that fear moves in. There's not an opportunity for us to be confused unless we separate ourselves and get out from under the understanding that God knows. There's not an opportunity for us to see failure and to get our eyes on calamity because we start to walk into an understanding, just as been mentioned this morning, and it's another piece of the puzzle. That's bad. No, it's good. God is taking pieces that have been in the box that we couldn't find a place for those pieces. How many times have you took a piece and it just doesn't fit? There's a gap there and I can't find anything that fits like it should. And oh, I think there was times when I was a little guy that I threatened to take a piece out of the jigsaw puzzle box and take my pocket knife and try to make it fit. Have you ever done that? Well, it doesn't work. It does not work, because before long, the piece that you just cut up, you need it in its fullness to fill up another gap that you didn't see. God is wanting us to be aware that He knows, and He put all of the pieces of your life in a box, and He's putting you together, and each piece is significant, and each piece is a part that is essential to your life. And how many times have I cried out, Lord, I don't want this piece. Let's just throw this one away. I can't find a place for it to go. No doubt there's a mistake was made. Somebody made a mistake. This one doesn't belong. And throw that piece in the garbage can. There'll come a day when you need that piece. You can't discard anything that God has put in your life. As unacceptable as it may look, and as unacceptable as it may seem, it is essential to fulfill God's perfect plan in your life. And sometimes those are hard places. Sometimes those are the places that we just say, I don't know that I can do this. But God knows. And I am coming to a greater knowledge that I know who holds tomorrow. God spoke something to me years ago. Another piece of the puzzle. And you know what I've decided? That many times there may be identical pieces that fit in different places. And at times they are essential. And then that same piece or that same shape or those same words or that same understanding becomes essential for something down the road. God spoke to me and He said, you're not always forewarned, but you're always forearmed. God knows. How is He forearming you? In ways that we don't understand. How is He preparing you? He had a man that couldn't talk. Sing me a song. An essential piece of the puzzle. Oh, I was blessed by it way back in 1957, 58, 59, as I was just a teenager, as I was trying to back him up on the guitar as best as I could. It was a blessing. Loved Richard, but I felt more from that song this morning. Just like you said, Sandy. He ministered. He ministered. God knows. He puts all of these things in place because we are to be complete in Him. So, this is the best place I've ever been, Phyllis. The most complete place I have ever been. God is continuing to put the pieces of my puzzle together. And I don't know what to expect. And I'm trying not to anticipate. Except with a positive attitude. I told Paula this morning. She was concerned. She was cooking this morning. So I'd have food for this week. Because she's going to be out of pocket a lot. And she was showing her concern. And I said, I'm more optimistic this morning than I've been. I feel more positive than I've felt. And so, thank God, He knows.
Yes, yes.
And if He knows, there's nothing to worry about. God bless you this morning. Someone want to say something before dismissed? Again, thank you for your ministry, your support, and your strength. Keep in mind that there is a possibility that we might incorporate a trip to Paris and to the campgrounds next Sunday. Zach will kind of leave that up to you of how you want to manage that. But that sounds like a very positive thing to happen if it can be put together.
I can take my van and take some people.
That would be great.
And the rest can pile in the back of Zach's truck. Where we're going? Call us. Yes, and see where the camp is.
Yeah, that would be neat. That would be next Sunday.
I know. I'm at the camp. Is that the camp for next year?
Yes, for next year, yes. All right. God bless you. Thank you for being here. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord.